Turning to 1 Corinthians, and we're turning to chapter 7, please. 1 Corinthians chapter 7. And this evening, God willing, we will get to the end of this chapter, which, if you've been following along each week, you'll be thinking, that's a big section to finish with, which it is. But as I trust the Lord will guide us this evening, I have an approach, a strategy, in a sense, as I seek to look at this portion of Scripture. When I began chapter 7, I didn't really think I'd get to the end in one piece. But we've got there, we're getting there. And I appreciate the response and the feedback that some have given so far in these studies. And again, I've been praying that God will bless and use this message to his own honor and glory this evening. I want to read the portion of Scripture. It is rather lengthy, so just allow me to have that time this evening. But it would be good for us just to carefully read these words as we come to our message. The message this evening, or our study, which it is a Bible study, I've really put it as a question. Marriage or singleness, is one better for the Christian? So marriage or singleness, is one better for the Christian? That's the question, I believe, that in many respects is being dealt with by the Apostle Paul in this passage. And for this, we want to read from 1 Corinthians 7 and verse 25. Now, concerning virgins, Paul says, I have no commandment of the Lord, yet I give my judgment as one that hath obtained mercy of the Lord to be faithful. I suppose, therefore, that this is good for the present distress. I say that it is good for a man so to be. Art thou bound unto a wife? Seek not to be loosed. Art thou loosed from a wife? Seek not a wife. But, and if thou marry, thou hast not sinned. And if a virgin marry, she hath not sinned. Nevertheless, such shall have trouble in the flesh, but I spare you. But this I say, brethren, the time is short. It remaineth that both they that have wives be as though they had none, and they that weep as though they wept not, and they that rejoice as though they rejoice not, and they that buy as though they possessed not, and they that use this world as not abusing it. For the fashion of this world passeth away. But I would have you without carefulness. He that is unmarried careth for the things that belong to the Lord, how he may please the Lord. But he that is married careth for the things that are of the world, how he may please his wife. There is difference also between a wife and a virgin. The unmarried woman careth for the things of the Lord, that she may be holy both in body and in spirit. But she that is married careth for the things of the world, how she may please her husband. And this I speak for your own profit, not that I may cast a snare upon you, but for that which is comely, and that ye may attend upon the Lord without distraction. But if any man think he behaveth himself uncomely towards his virgin, if she pass the flower of her age, and needs so require, let him do what he will, he sinneth not, let them marry. Nevertheless, he that standeth steadfast in his heart, having no necessity, but hath power over his own will, and hath so decreed in his heart that he will keep his virgin, doeth well. So that he that giveth her in marriage doeth well, but he that giveth her not in marriage doeth better. The wife is bound by the law as long as her husband liveth, but if her husband be dead, she is at liberty to be married to whom she will, only in the Lord. But she is happier if she so abide, after my judgment. And I think also that I have the Spirit of God. As you can see, it's a lengthy passage, and quite naturally, when you look at it, it can present itself as being somewhat intimidating, and it is. But we trust the Lord will give us a lot of grace and help this evening as we look at the Word of God. Marriage or singleness, is one better for the Christian? Let's seek the Lord together in prayer for a few moments, please. Father in heaven, we just fall again on our knees before thee, and we just bow ourselves before thy majesty. And Lord, I plead for the understanding of God this evening. And if we've come to the Bible study this evening with our minds here and there, Lord, allow the distractions now to be taken away. And in this moment, may there be a constant cry that just comes from our hearts, Lord, teach me these things. and give me a hunger for the word. And Lord, help me to live my Christian life in light of the truth that thou, O God, has given to us. Lord, I believe it's a word for every single one of us this evening. And I pray for thee to give the help and to have the honor. Lord, we're not here to see men or ourselves glorified. We're not even here just to build up knowledge for the sake of it. We want to glorify our God. We want to worship thee. And we pray for thee to give us grace. We ask in the Savior's name. Amen. Now, the question this evening, which I put to you by way of our study, marriage or singleness, is one better for the Christian? Now, quite naturally, it requires a bit more explanation so that we understand our terms this evening. For example, we are referring to the biblical definition of marriage and the biblical definition of what I've referred to as singleness. Now, with respect to marriage, I don't mean to say too much. We must stress all aspects of biblical marriage. It's always a grief that you have to say marriage between a man and a woman, but in the days in which we live, you have to keep re-emphasizing these things. And I don't think we have to go into great detail this evening. We understand, to some extent already from these studies, but even just our knowledge of the Bible, what we mean by biblical marriage. So when I asked the question, marriage or singleness is one better, you'll understand what I mean by marriage according to Scripture. So what about singleness? What is being referred to here? Well, let me just remind you of precisely what Paul says in verse 25, because this is what he has in view. He says, now concerning virgins. He means those who are unmarried and live a life of celibacy. In other words, Paul is not using the world's view. He's not using the ungodly and the unsaved view or understanding of what singleness is in their eyes. In other words, where men and women have multiple physical relationships and all outside of marriage. That's not what we're referring to. And I want to make that clear, and I know that's what you understand anyway. So those are our terms when we say marriage and we say singleness in light of what Scripture is saying. So is one better? Or is one preferable? Or is one more advantageous for the Christian? What I would say to that is, I'm going to give you a general answer in terms of the nutshell, and then we're going to go into the details. In overall summary of the passage, we have to stand back and say, well, if we use the word better, no, one isn't better. And we can't come down that line of thinking. Is there in some context or in some settings or in some circumstances an advantage when it comes to singleness? Yes. That's the very point that Paul is making in this passage. It's a bit of a no and a bit of a yes answer. You say it's a cop-out, Pastor, but it isn't when you follow with me this evening, as we shall see. Now, verses such as verse 28, look at verse 28 before we go to our main points. Paul makes it clear that if a believer marries, that it's not a sin. And if someone has been maybe a virgin or celibate, they've married and they married again, or someone's a widow and they marry again, or in other settings that we've explained already in this portion, they haven't sinned. What if someone remains a virgin and they remain unmarried? Well, she or he has neither sinned. And if you look at verse 28, that's what Paul says. But, and if thou marry, thou hast not sinned, and if a virgin marry, she hath not sinned. And so he's making it clear, even in verses such as this, and it's important to see this, that he wants the people in Corinth to understand that in this situation, he's not talking about saying, how can someone be better than another Christian? How can someone attain a higher walk with God? That's not what he's dealing with here. It's a different scenario altogether. It's also helpful to see that Paul's reasoning here is to show God's people that they are not to be tied up in a struggle when it comes to matters like this or similar ones. In other words, Christian, a really important principle, by the way, throughout Scripture. There are no inconsistencies for the Christian when they're faced with differing situations and they choose different options so long as whatever action we take is not sinful. Now, that's what he has in mind here. And he makes it really clear in the likes of verse 28. But what you'll find is when you go to the end of the chapter, And what I want to do by way of introduction is just deal with the end before we get to the middle part. In many ways, he illustrates it again and again. This idea of just comforting the Christian and saying, look, there's no inconsistencies if you choose this path or you choose that path, so long as that path is not in itself inherently sinful and wrong. And to make that abundantly clear, look at verse 26. We'll just jump forward a little bit here. He brings two other pictures into view. And I'm not going to spend a great time with this because I'm mindful of the time I need for the rest. But let me just mention them in passing. Does a father allow his daughter to marry or not? Putting aside the sort of intricate questions around that, that's more or less what he's talking about in verse 36 when he speaks of a man and his virgin. It's to do with the daughter. It's to do with the father. It's to do with, you know, does he keep that daughter? Does he hold her back from marrying? Or if there is a pressing need and there's a reason why, well, he lets her go forward to be married. That's the debate. That's the discussion. And again, he's saying that there's no inconsistency either way. So long as the person is not being pressed against their will, so long as there's no sin which has taken place. And then he mentions at the end, the likes of the widow, the wife is bound by the law as long as her husband liveth. But if her husband be dead, she's at liberty to marry only in the law. That's the only condition. But if she remains unmarried and she never marries again and she's happier to abide after what Paul says is my judgment, that's fine as well. So three times, and I want to make this a point this evening, in this closing section, he's given three significant illustrations to remind the Christian church that there are occasions where we might take one route and another route. It might be marriage. It might remain as we are. But we're not to look over our shoulder at one person and say, I'm better than you or you're worse than me. There are no inconsistencies in either of them. In many respects, that's the overview of the passage. But what we find then as we just retrace our steps and we go back to verse 26 through to 35 is that he's focusing particularly and primarily upon what he has initially introduced in verse 25 concerning virgins or those who are celibate and those who remain unmarried. And he's dealing with that as the main argument in this passage. And we're going to see exactly why in just a few moments. So as we come to this question, marriage or singleness, is one better than the other? There are really two approaches that we come with this evening. First of all, let's look at Paul's answer in what I call the immediate situation. Paul's answer in the immediate situation. For this, we're looking at verses 25 to 28. Now, it seems to be, from what I can tell, doing a bit of study on this, that in Corinth, there was contention around this particular this matter, this issue. Now, that's not surprising already. Those of you that have stayed the course so far for these studies in Corinth, we're at the stage where we're not surprised when we find another problem in Corinth, because that just seems to be the way things are snowballing here in this book. But Paul, as this great pastor and man of God, he's dealing with them, and he's got the mind of God, and he's coming with the wisdom of God, and he's coming with instruction and teaching. And you know what? He's coming very carefully, but at the same time, he's coming with great authority. And I think I like that about Paul, and it's a tremendous lesson for all of us. Now in Corinth, there was a contention surrounding maybe a question which had been raised. And it had come from the quarters of those that were promoting an erroneous belief. And the belief was this, that to remain a virgin and unmarried would be the way in which you promote godliness and purity over and against those who are married. Now, that is just not the case. And Paul is making that very clear. Those that hold to a strange notion that they won't marry, they'll stay there because this will in itself, in some mysterious way, promote purity and holiness. No, as Paul will say later, yes, you might have time to dedicate to God, but it doesn't sort of essentially make you more holy. And again, with all the strange notions in Corinth that were abounding, this was one of them. And it just simply wasn't true. And that is why Paul, in his passage, he stresses that neither state is sinful. And he mentions why in the likes of verse 35. He says, I speak this for your own profit. Paul's whole endeavor here, as he tackles this error which had filled into the church, is that he wants everyone in Corinth to be edified. That's his chief concern. And so look at verse 35 again. He speaks for their own profit. He doesn't want to cast a snare upon them. He doesn't want to trap them in some way. Everything he says is to build them up and encourage them. And to do that, he's going to tackle these problems and deal with the error which had arisen. I thought about that this afternoon as I was doing the study. And you know what? It brought the question home to my heart. That always has to be our approach, you know, when we're handling difficult, sensitive, really, really struggling situations. What is our main intention, whether it's a pastor or as Christians? Surely it must always to be edified. To make sure that what we do doesn't ensnare people and trap people, but encourages them, builds them up, instructs them, does all the things which are necessary. That's what Paul is doing in this passage. And in many respects, you've got to see that as part of the background. He's dealing with, again, these problems which had arisen, erroneous views. And he says, no, you're not better in the sense of being more holy if you're married or if you remain a virgin. There'll be some advantages, he'll deal with that, but not making you more holy in a sense, or less holy. Now, Paul begins, if you notice how he begins this evening, Christian, he begins by using this language in verse 25, he says, now concerning virgins, I have no commandment of the Lord. What does he mean? Let me just reduce it down to just a very basic level here this evening. And in my own words, he says, I can't turn you to book, chapter, and verse in the Old Testament scripture. You can't come to me with a question and say, should virgins remain unmarried or should they seek to get married? And he says, I can't turn you to Genesis or Exodus, Leviticus, and tell you, you know, where to find the verse that tells you what to do in that situation. And he can't turn to any of the, maybe what were some of the existing New Testament portions of Scripture. He can't do that. But he says, what I give you is my judgment. Now notice he says this in verse 25. As one that hath obtained mercy of the Lord to be faithful. Believe it or not, there's some strange notions that abound as to what Paul means by that. The most simple understanding is this, that God has been pleased to discharge his faithful office to me as apostle. Some think, oh, Paul draws from his own personal experience. It's not the case. Putting aside Paul's own situation. Time and time again through this book, it's about this, that God has put into my hand this judgment. I've obtained mercy to be a faithful preacher and apostle. Have you noticed that at the end of this portion, at the end of the chapter, he says something very curious. He says at the end of verse 40, and I think also that I have the Spirit of God. Now, we might read those words and say, well, Paul, do you not know if you have the Spirit of God? You know, it sort of almost puts everything into doubt. You know, I think I have the Spirit of God. You know, as if you're sort of saying, you know, I think it might snow, or I think it might rain, or I think it might be sunny next week. We, you know, do you not know these things? Paul, you say you think you have the Spirit of God? What he does there, as he's done before, he speaks in what we call an ironical fashion. Remember how there were so many in Corinth, and they were trying to belittle Paul. And they were trying to make themselves to be great influencers and teachers in the church. And they've come with the mind. They hadn't. They had come with the Spirit of God. They hadn't. They were sowing discord. Paul just throws it in at the end. In other words, what he's actually saying is, I have apostolic authority. Everything I say here, while it's a judgment that is from myself, it's a judgment which is made by the mercy that God has given to me to be a faithful minister of the gospel. And you know what? All of you that think you have the Spirit of God, I think I have the Spirit of God as well. And he's gently rebuking them. He knows he has the Spirit of God. That just adds a little bit more impetus to our thoughts this evening. That what we're dealing with here is authority from Paul. And therefore, we take it very seriously and we take it very carefully. Now, what I believe we see here, before we move to our last point, is that Paul's answer, because we're dealing with Paul's answer in the immediate situation, it indicates tremendous wisdom. I don't know if you're like me, maybe you're more acute when you're studying the scriptures, but I'll be very honest with you. I have, until this very day, always missed a little phrase in verse 26. And you know what? That phrase is absolutely critical to make any sense of what you're reading in this whole chapter, this passage, I should say. Look at verse 26. He says this. I suppose, therefore, that this is good for the present distress. That's the key, Christian. Now, I missed that. I'll be honest with you. I've missed that. And I've read that chapter many times, and maybe I've rushed, maybe something's been happening, and I've just missed that. But that is the key. If you're gonna get to the bottom of why Paul seems, and it's not just that he seems, he is saying to those who remain as virgins, those who remain unmarried, in some capacity, there's an advantage to be had. And you say, well, what is the advantage? And he says this in verse 26, for the present distress. That begs the question, what distress? What was the pressing matter, Paul? If you have a margin, it might translate it as necessity, the present need. So there was something that was looming, or there's something that was pressing in upon the church. And all commentators, as I've been scouring around, looking around as to different views and so on, it's all coming down to the same angle, which again, I believe is right and biblical, that there in Corinth, what do we have? We've got a church that God has established, don't we? And you've got the gospel taking root in Corinth, and you've got souls being saved, and the church is being built up, but you've got this whole pagan world around it. And from the inception, in New Testament terms, from the inception of when the kingdom of God is established in terms of New Testament circumstances and the kingdom being preached and the apostles going out and churches being added, what always followed the growth of the church? Persecution. What was always there at hand? Persecution. They would go preaching the word, but there was persecution. And now we're moving into Corinth, where we're away from Jerusalem, we're away from Judea, we're away from Samaria, we're into the regions, and it's the very same thing again. And so whether it's right at their doorstep, or it'll be on the very next day, Paul is saying, in the present situation, in the present circumstances, in the necessity or present distress, I say it is good for a man so to be. You've got to understand that this evening. Our Lord Jesus told the apostles, in the world there will be tribulation. And we know in the early church it was very intense and with great loss of life. And so why would it be advantageous or in some respects preferable to remain unmarried in that situation? Well, I mean, it doesn't take too much, you know, thinking, does it? It's quite logical now. It makes sense. If a person marries or remains unmarried, even with that threat looming, Paul makes it clear, look, if you do marry, you're not committing a sin. Don't worry. Maybe some were thinking of getting married and the persecution was very much at their door. And some were saying, is that wise? You could bring children to the world. You could suffer. You could lose your wife. You could lose your husband. You could really struggle. Paul says, look, I'm not saying it's a sin to marry. But in the present distress, think about it. Think carefully. We only have to look over the records of church history to see where persecution has hit the church. Husbands lose their wives, and wives lose their husbands, and fathers lose their daughters, and mothers lose their sons. And it's heartbreaking stories. And again, it always was stepping back saying it's not right or wrong. That's not what he's dealing with here. It's saying what's maybe preferable in the immediate situation? What's advantageous, he's saying? Consider the agony that could be experienced. In fact, if you look at verse 28, he says, nevertheless, such shall have trouble in the flesh. You know what? It would make no sense if Paul was saying that if you get married, you'll have trouble in the flesh. I mean, that's not a good advertisement for marriage, is it? You know, imagine that being pastoral advice. You're going to get trouble if you get married. You know, so he's not talking about that. He's not belittling marriage. He said elsewhere what a blessing it is, what an honor it is, what a privilege it is if it's our lot and portion in life. And he's not dealing with the fact that you've got, you know what, some struggles in marriage life. We all know those things happen, but that's not his argument here. In verse 28, he says, nevertheless, such as shall have trouble in the flesh in terms of persecution, but I'll spare you. He says, you know what, I won't pull back the curtain and let you see how you might lose your loved one. I'll spare you that agony. But as an apostle and with my judgment and what Paul understands is looming upon the church and what was an immediate need in that moment, he speaks with tremendous godly wisdom. That's why I say it is a bit of a yes and no answer. Because in that pressing circumstance, well, it makes sense to me, I hope it does to you, that you maybe just think carefully about what has taken place. And as we remind ourselves of what we're learning here this evening, it enforces into my heart, and I trust to you as well, that God's people, if we just now think more genuinely about the Christian life, God's people must always make choices in the light of two things. In the light of the fear of God, every time. And also in the light of any circumstances we live in. And that means we must always be seeking great wisdom. Choices we make, decisions we make. And wanting and desiring the wisdom of God. So that was Paul's answer in what I call the immediate situation. But there's something else, and we'll finish with this. We now look at Paul's assessment in the wider setting. Because like so many of Paul's writings, when he begins with one truth, he then takes that truth and he broadens it out by way of application to every single person or everyone within the church. That's how you now understand verses 29 to 34. Paul's assessment of the wider setting. And again, he will come back to this initial question time and time again, but he's now just allowing every Christian to have a word in season. There's something for everyone in this moment. And the first thing we see in his assessment is how we evaluate our remaining time. And I don't mean my remaining time, which is still a little bit longer. A bit longer would be better, but I've got some time left this evening. But how we evaluate our remaining time in life. When was the last time, Christian, we evaluated our time? Our days, our weeks, our months, maybe our years. Have you noticed what he says in verse 29? Let me get back to my portion of scripture here. He says, but this I say, brethren. So you notice how he's just shifting it now, and he's more general. But this I say, brethren, that the time is short, it remaineth. Or some would maybe slightly render that differently, that the time or the remaining time is short. The time is short. The time that remains is short. And then he moves into a whole realm of illustrations as to what can change so quickly. But the main point he makes here, Christian, and you know what, there's not one of us this evening, no matter who we are, who does not benefit from this. Time is short. That's not a hard message. It's just straightforward, isn't it? It's everyday language. And the description here is about time itself. And it's drawing together that the word, the time is short, or the phrase, comes from this idea of being poured in together or drawn together. The Bible commentator Albert Barnes used the illustration of the furling of a sail and the pulling in of the sail and the wrapping of the sail around the pole. And that's our life, isn't it? The sail is gradually being drawn, it's being furled, it's being wrapped up again, and it's going to come to an end in a sense. And this is a reality for the Christian. It's not just for married people or for those who are not married. It's everyone inclusive. And the point that we see that now for is that with the time being short, we must evaluate our lives before God. And you know what? The Christian in the Bible is constantly being drawn, not just simply to the brevity of life itself, which is right before your eyes this evening, but as Peter mentions in other portions of Scripture, the approach of our Savior's return in tandem with it. So that we read of how the time is short and the coming of Christ is near, the application is this, not so much chronology, but that all remaining time prior both to our own death or the Savior's return requires godly focus. So that when Paul says to the Christian church, and he says, your time is short, he's not just saying, now's your countdown, and you've got so long left. He's saying, with that time being short, where's the focus? Where's the focus? And that, you know, that was to encourage people. You might not think it, but it was. And I thought about this earlier on. I thought, what a tremendous encouragement for those that came under the category of virgins or those unmarried. You say, well, how? Why? Because such a life may seem long, may seem drawn out, and lonely. And lonely. And Paul points out, you know what? Don't get sucked into the world's imposing mindset on your life or where you are. And of course, those pangs will be felt and those struggles will be experienced, just as if there will be other issues, whether married or not. But don't think in those terms. Think more in this respect. Time is short. So what do you do with it? And how do you now render this to God? See, it was a great pastoral word. When you think of the complexity of the whole narrative here. And so he begins, isn't he? Verse 29. Marriages are for a time. You know when he says in verse 29, the time is short, remaineth that both they that have wives be as though they had none. He's not sort of putting a sort of negative, to sort of disparaging look to marriage and saying, you know what, it's nothing, it means nothing. He's illustrating the brevity here, the time being short. And we know that because he just keeps on building the list here. So he goes on to say that they that weep as though they wept not. Now, Paul, what are you saying here? He's not saying we don't weep, we will weep, but don't be consumed by your weeping. And if you're given in marriage, don't be so consumed by the marriage that there's no use to God in your life. And that's what he takes right through this passage. And they that rejoice, and maybe we joy and we find gladness and satisfaction in things which are legitimate in this world in which we live. But don't be like the world where all you live is just to satisfy your joys, your pleasures, your wants. That's not what you do as a Christian. And likewise, he goes on into verse 30, and he says, as they that buy, as though they possess not. Maybe sometimes that's how we feel anyway. I think these days when you go into the shops and you spend money on food, it's like you have nothing in your hands. But he's not talking along those lines. He's saying, don't be overly consumed by this. They that use the world as not abusing it. We use the world and we live in the world, but your time is short. And these things come to a close. And there is a greater day, a better day. Christian, everything must be assessed by this truth, the time is short. Everything we do. So when did you and when did I last assess aspects and details and parts and needs of our life by that? Maybe you've been overwhelmed by something. It's taken you're almost half your life away. And every living thought is about this and about, you know, what I feel I need or think I need or what problem I have. And I'm not belittling the problems. I'm not doing that. I'm saying that one of the great approaches is to get away from it all and use this approach. The time is short. It's a godly assessment of a wider setting. And so he says it's short. And then he says in verse 31 that another argument in terms of how we approach or evaluate our remaining time is that the fashion of this world passeth away. Look at verse 31. The fashion of this world passeth away. Now, sorry to disappoint you, he's not talking about whether he approves of dungarees or whether you should wear denim or not. Not that sort of fashion. I was telling the children the other day when they were bemoaning, I think, something they had to wear. I said, you have no idea what I had to wear in the 80s and 90s. It was a particularly bizarre age, wasn't it, for clothes. And I remember seeing these photos of this weird multicolored jumper. My hair wasn't cut, even worse than what it is now, by the way. And these jeans with Fred Flintstone on it and all sorts of weird things and like orange shoes. I didn't know what my parents were thinking at the time. I thought they were just having fun with me. And then I saw the rest of my siblings. I thought, that's what they did. That's how they dressed us. It's not that sort of fashion. We're not dealing with clothing. Do you know what Paul's saying here? When he says about the fashion of this world passeth away, he says the form of it, the appearance of it, it's transient. It's soon gone. Soon gone. Do not be consumed by it. There'll be another form, an eternal home soon established. The fashion of it passeth away. And therefore, that's how we evaluate our remaining time. So then, as I finish here, how do we utilize our remaining time? How do we use it? Well, to use the argument he brings before those who are married, those who are virgins, those that remain unmarried, and so on. You see, it's not enough for us as Christians to just say that we know that time is short and the world is passing away. Even unsaved people know that's true, okay? Even the most diehard atheists, materialistic people, in their very core being, still accept the fact time is short and the world is passing away, okay? They can't deny that. The Christian does something else that's different. We don't just sort of look at that in a philosophical sense and say, you know what, that's true. Because, as I said, many unsaved people say the same. We do something even more. We go a step further. And we say, the time being short, how can I use my time to please God and honor him? So that raises the question with which Paul is finishing with here. Is it possible to serve or please God better if remaining single compared to marriage? Now remember, I've made the point. He's not saying, make it abundantly clear that one state or the other, it makes you more or less holy. He doesn't. But at the same time, you can't hide from what he's saying in this portion. It's just a plain fact. He says, if you remain never to marry and a virgin, and that's the lot that God has given you, there is given into your hands the ability to give more of your time to God. And that's just illustrated by the fact that he makes it, and I'll go through these words, you can read it yourself, that for the wife and so for the husband, well, what do they have to do? In verse 34, well, they care for their loved one, they care for their spouse, they care for the things of the world, not worldly things, but how to please the husband. That's right, that's good, that's proper, that's to be expected. And so he's addressing the individuals who aren't married, and he says, it's not you're better or you're worse, but there's time. You know what you can find on both sides of the coin? Very diligent, very vigilant, very godly married men and women, and those who are single, those not married, and you can find also those who are lazy who are married and those who are single. It works both ways. But he does have to address the question, and he's not going to duck it, and he's not going to hide from it. And he just makes a simple observation in those last two verses, and he says that my word to you is that you don't be a person who's encumbered by care. Look at verse 32. I would have you without carefulness or as anxiety. That you've got an opportunity here. If you're never to marry, and that's what God gives you, don't see it as reproach. Don't see it as a stigma. Don't see it in the light of the world. But listen, see it as an opportunity because you're married to Christ. You're in union with him. And you can give it to him, your time. In a sense, it's a golden opportunity. I love that about that portion of Scripture. I think it's heartwarming. It's brilliant. Brethren and sisters, our time is short. Too short to be sidetracked by the world and the things of this world. And it's too short to be sidetracked by working out, as people in Corinth here, which one makes me better with God. That's not the issue. It's not right or wrong, but it's redeeming the time with the state and the condition that God has put you into. And that's the point he makes in this portion. I thank God that whether we find ourselves married, with children, without children, single, never to marry, or maybe in the future to marry, whatever the situation is, God is so pleased to use every single one of us. And he will. Oh, that we would just understand what he's saying within this portion of Scripture, in the likes of verse 35, that we serve God without distraction, that we serve him with a heart that is there to please him. May the Lord give us grace and help to do these things and be such Christians for his name's sake. Amen. Amen.